Thank you very much. Alex said something just a moment ago that I think really summarizes the summary of the night. Awesome, but scary. A lot of the technologies that we talk about, and it's not just this set of in some ways a narrow set of electronic technologies, there's a whole panoply of things that technological interventions into how our mind works, how our brain works. All of them can be summed up as awesome and scary. Now, I've given this talk a few times, and normally I start out by giving an example of, oh, these are the kinds of biochemical interventions that we've used for millennia, and this is really not an uncommon thing to alter our brains. And that's great, that's true. And go on, look at, show pictures of Prozac and things like that. But there was something that just came up this week that I really needed to include in my talk tonight. These are glial cells, which are essentially, to put it in a very basic way, these are the substructure of the brain. They connect neurons together and basically give the scaffolding for brain assembly. And there is some really interesting work done by researchers at the University of Rochester and the University of Copenhagen that said, hey, why don't we take some human glial cell precursors, basically the not quite stem cells that will develop into glial cells, and stick them into the brain of a newborn mouse. And let's see what happens, because that's what you do. And it turns out that the human glial cells will completely replace all of the mouse glial cells, just completely. And the mouse is smarter. Now, within a range of, this is still a mouse, but still, the mouse is smarter. So think about that for a second. What you're doing, you're creating what's called a transgenic chimera. You're putting human cells into this mouse, and it's becoming smarter. Now it's becoming just a little bit smarter. But what happens when that little bit gets to be a lot? We sort of slide into this idea of, hey, let's just do this because it looks cool. It sounds cool. And when we start getting into the realm of things like, imagined drugs that can make you smarter. Now, this is not real, but it could be. Something that goes and will literally make you smarter. For a short period of time, you have to re-inject every couple of days or something. We can become lab rats. And this is not to say this is a bad thing, but it's to say we really need to think through the ethical, political, social, cultural implications of what we're doing with these technologies. Not to say stop, but to just say why. This is the Magna Carta, a 800-odd-year-old document that was really, in many ways, the fundamental document that led to the emergence of a democratic society. It's basically laid out restrictions on the rights of kings. So what I want to see is the creation of a Magna Cortica, a rule set to play out, to really list and explore what are the rights, what are the responsibilities, what are the bright lines that we should not cross, what are the things that we should encourage people to do, what should we do with these neural technologies? Because as you've seen demonstrated tonight, as you see just by following the news, this is a field that's advancing very quickly. And the things that sound like science fiction, like transgenic chimera mice, become reality far more swiftly than you might expect. So what I'm going to do here is actually describe a set of five basic principles that I mean not as hard and fast, these are what the rules should be, period, underscore. But here are some suggestions. They may be wrong. I want to try to begin this conversation about what are the rights, what are the responsibilities, what are the ethical norms around cognitive augmentation. And the first one, I think, is something that we all probably agree with. The right to self-knowledge, the right to know what's going on in your own head. Now, it's actually kind of cool. There's some really interesting, we just saw this, really interesting technology that let you scan your head and see what's going on in your brain to greater and lesser degrees of precision. And any of you who've had real surgery lately know that you can probably get a nice, a sweet DVD of the video of the surgery taking place. You can get that, the camera snaking through your knee or whatever. And so you should be able to get that same kind of thing. Here's a DVD of this brain scan. That's kind of cool. I have a friend who had an fMRI done and got the DVD. This should be the norm. If you have that analysis done, you should have access to it. Now, just as a small parallel, some of you may have noticed I wear hearing aids. And I do not have access to the settings. I can go to an audiologist, and the audiologist can alter things. They'll show me on the screen what the settings are. I can make suggestions, but I don't have access. I can't see what's going on, almost inside my head. So, second one, a right of self-modification. And this is basically saying that we should have the right to make changes. That should be something that's allowed to us. And actually what you'll see, if you look at the news in America over the past couple of years, there's been a real move towards the legalization of cannabis, which is, in one way, just a small example of the notion of you own your own brain. You have the right to alter it. But in many ways, more important would be a right to say no, a right to refuse modification. And if that sounds like it's kind of why would you have to worry about that? Of course you would. Think about how far you would go professionally if you said, I don't want to carry a mobile phone. I think that's intrusive. I think it's horrible for my personal life, et cetera. I don't want to carry a mobile phone. At this point in time, at this point in history, that is effectively, functionally unacceptable. If you want to have a sustained professional life, heck, if you want to have a sustained personal life, especially if you're younger, you have to have a mobile phone. So imagine a world where there you get that same kind of pressure to having neural modification, neural augmentation. And this is not as ridiculous as it might sound, because imagine a situation where, as is happening already in places in universities and in Silicon Valley research labs, people are using prescription medicines that are designed for specific therapeutic interventions and using them as a way to function better. So Provigil, modafinil, it keeps you awake. It keeps you awake without being a stimulant, and it works really well. And there are people who use it to be able to stay up for 48, 72 hours working through that time so they can get ahead. Or take Vyvanse or Ritalin, any number of these kinds of amphetamine-based stimulants that work to essentially to counter attention deficit disorder. People are using them, who don't have a prescription for it, people are using them as study aids, as work aids. And a world where you have ready access to these kinds of interventions, and you're competing with other folks who have ready access to these interventions for promotions, for jobs, militarily. What happens? What does the world look like when you can say no, but you might end up losing out? You do. Corresponding with both of these is a right to modify or refuse to modify your children. And if this sounds a little scary, I'd like to introduce you to Louise Brown, a baby born in 1978, the first in vitro fertilization baby, or as you've known at the time, the first test tube baby. And those of you who were around at the time may remember the uproar surrounding her birth. This was horrific. You had James Watson, co-discoverer of the structure of DNA, saying that this could literally lead to the end of civilization. I'm not joking. There were people who believed that the advent of this technology was destructive to society and its norms. And at this point, I would be shocked if there wasn't anyone in the room who had either tried in vitro fertilization, successfully used IVF, or maybe even have been born via IVF. It's common. It's boring. And that's the same kind of situation that we'll be encountering around cognitive augmentation. At some point, it will seem boring. And finally, and probably the most controversial, and it's hard to read, is the right to know who has been modified. And I use the photo from Frankenstein, torch-bearing mobs of Frankenstein, intentionally. It is a real dilemma. the question of, do you want to know, should you be able to know who has been modified? And if your initial reaction is, well, of course not, that will lead to discrimination, probably. But would you want to know if your surgeon was using cognitive augmentation interventions? Would you want to know if your child's kindergarten teacher was on smart drugs? Would you want to know if your pilot, for as long as we have pilots, was on some kind of cognitive altering intervention, whether it's a brain chip or a drug or whatever? They're sniffing the right kind of microbes. I have no idea what you just said. Or a hearing aid. Yeah, that's, yes, thank you. Or a cochlear implant. That's probably, more to the point. You are these kind of direct interventions into how your brain works. Well, should you have the right? And like I said, I throw these five out there not as a suggestion about, here are what these rules should be, but more as an opening to the conversation. What should the rules be? Because we need them. We are already lab rats. And as we know, as we've seen, the mazes that we get to run are getting more and more interesting, more and more powerful. And this is precisely the kind of situation that begs us, that asks us to think ahead, and it asks us to imagine the road, imagine the path, map the journey before we reach the crossroads. Thank you. Yeah, I can take a few questions. You and then you.
Will these rules apply to the government also?
Yes. Will this apply to government? Well, of course. Or maybe should it apply? Of course. Will it? That's an interesting question. And you get these kinds of, these big questions of who does this apply to? Does it just apply to individuals? You have the right as an individual to do something, or you don't have the right to do something, like I can't hack my own hearing aid? Does it apply to companies? Does it apply to everyone? And if it applies to one government, does it apply to all governments? And so if China is doing something that the US says, no, that's morally unacceptable, but it gives China an economic or political or military advantage, does it remain morally unacceptable?
Thanks. There were so many things I wanted to ask, so I will restrict myself right now to two quick ones. First, I was recently at the Pentagon, and they make me put my phone in a little drawer, which they then lock and close away. So what happens when these things are implants? Do you have to turn off your intelligence? Do you have to? I mean, already I could hack a cochlear implant, for example, to secretly record things. Mm-hmm. Fortunately, they aren't telling people they have to be deaf to go into a room. But in essence, do you get to define what your cognitive state is, and that is unassailable? And then the flip side of that is, effectively, intelligence is already a commodity, which we're able to buy. And here in Palo Alto, we buy it in spades. And in other places, even here in the Bay Area, it isn't as available. So when that becomes more tangible, and you can really buy a drug, or you can get an implant, and it will measurably immediately make you smarter, and it comes at a cost. Therefore, the richer you are, the smarter you are. I didn't feel like there was a rule there addressing it, and yet, boy, did that seem like a big and contentious issue.
Thank you. That's a perfect question, and I think I have a number six. That's exactly the kinds of thing that I'm hoping to get, this kind of, what are the other things that we should be considering? You're absolutely right.
So there are all sorts of behaviors that will make us smarter. There are all sorts of environmental factors that will make us smarter. Why is tech different? Why are we scared of that?
I think it's because it is one arena that is most obviously connected to income, because it's something that you can buy. You can buy a better brain that way. Now, you can make a good case that getting a piano, getting a Harvard education, all of these are also correlates. But I think the reason tech does this in a way that, where a piano doesn't, and a Harvard kind of does, elite education kind of does, is it makes you feel like, I have to keep up. If I don't buy that gadget, for my kids in particular, then they're going to fall behind. And that there's a level of anxiety that comes out of that that is hard to quantify. You have one over here who is, oh, you.
Yeah, narcotics. Like, I don't, what I'm trying to say is, if there's rules on something, don't you feel like more people want to break them? So,
yep.
Right. So,
bodybuilder with steroids, or a baseball player with all sorts of, you know, physical drugs. Yes. Do rules make people want to break them? Prohibitions do. You know, especially blanket prohibitions. So you could see a scenario where some kinds of bulking drugs that are carefully monitored and regulated may be allowable. In that scenario, even if all of them aren't. And you'll have far fewer people breaking the code, you know, breaking those rules if they actually have a pathway. And the parallel here is with Napster and iTunes, believe it or not. Napster really began to drop in popularity when the iTunes store opened up and people had the ability, sorry, I'm off camera here. When people had the ability to actually buy the things they wanted without having to break the law. They weren't into it to break the law. They were into it because they wanted access to something they couldn't get before. And when they had a legal, functional way to do it, they were happy to go with that.
So what if this technology was free?
What if it was free? Then you would have some people who use it, some people who abuse it, some people who ignore it. The difference being, and this is just like you'd have with it when it's costly, the difference being that you'll have a lot more people using, abusing, ignoring. You also probably have some people who wouldn't use it if it became free, because it loses the edge of being special. That's okay. That's okay. I mean, I can't tell you what exactly will happen, but I think that's an excellent question, because sometimes especially when we look at these kinds of technologies, we so often focus on, as Melina suggested, as you suggested, those economic questions of who has the right to it, who should be allowed, or what happens when you have economic divisions? What if it's really expensive? We forget to also ask what happens if it's really cheap. You know, what happens when these things are close to zero? That has enormous social and political and cultural implications as well. There was another one.
Humans love to push boundaries, and right now we're at the point where we're pushing boundaries of knowledge ever further, ever further. Shouldn't one of the rules be that the rules can change, because we're going to learn so much more, and the rules we make today will be just no good tomorrow? And what do we do about when you say you have the right to take or not take drugs, and we have ingestibles coming, and it will be reported back to your pharmacist, your doctor, and your insurance company? How much right are we going to have? What do we do about things like that? So we've got changing, pushing boundaries constantly, and I think that's the new frontier, is knowledge.
So pushing the boundaries, I think you're absolutely right that one of the rules should be the rules can change. There's also, you know, that whole notion of ingestibles really falls into to overlap with the question of privacy. You know, and so many of these technologies have implications around privacy. I mean, if you're having this brain, how do you know that the emotive or whatever brain reader doesn't upload that back to the emotive databases shared with the NSA? Which, for any emotive representatives, I'm just making a joke, but it's, you know, how do you know that this information about, in many ways, one of the most intimate parts of you, of who you are, your brain, how do you know that privacy isn't being broken? Here, and then up back up there.
Okay.
I'm sorry?
Let's make that second one the last question.
Okay.
Okay, I wanted to ask about the mouse who was altered. And what I want to know is is there any way of evaluating the mouse is smarter in mouse world or human world? Like, how are we evaluating smartness in mice? And similarly, are we not, by just having do we have a particular standard of evaluating that? And is it just becoming like, you know, a standardized idea?
So with the mouse, it's actually how quickly it can solve a maze. So it's very much in the mouse paradigm. Is it smarter as a mouse? But that just pushes off that question of what happens as these interventions become more meaningful, and you do get a biotech intervention that makes the mouse as smart as a dog. What happens when you get something that makes a dog as smart as a chimp? What happens if you make something a chimp as smart as a very smart person? What rights do they have? Are they still lab animals? Do you still have the right to, you know, stick them in the guillotine and cut off their heads for later examination? Because that's what they can do now.
So I have a scenario. What if you have access to the settings on your hearing aid and you use it in a way that injures yourself, and then you decide that you want to sue the company? So it doesn't seem to me that if a technology is more than a non-professional can manage, and then they can damage themselves, and then they might want to put the blame elsewhere.
I expect that's why, you know, that question of liability is why I don't have access to the settings. But of course, if I was the one who went in and monkeyed with my own settings and then decided to sue, then not only was I clumsy, but I was a jerk. But I think we've been told that's the last question I can take. I'm happy to take more questions as we're wandering around, and thank you very much for an enjoyable evening.
Awesome. All right, so in IFTF tradition, which involves standing up, I'm going to ask the speakers to face the audience, and let's all give them a standing ovation for an amazing job. Thank you so much. I feel like I just saw the room's EEG spike. Now I know something. So I want to thank everybody for coming. We have a little bit of time and some beer and wine left. We have Neuro+Tech events, which we welcome you to. I want to give special thanks to our IFTF volunteers who stayed late into the night to help with the event. And a thanks to Lori Frick, who is the artist behind all of these Neuro+Tech backsplash slides. She's an artist working on an installation called The Fine Line Between Art and Neuroscience. So thank you all for coming. Hope you'll stick around and chat with our great speakers. And thank you, Ben, especially.